And the last kind of front is occluded front. This is the most important front because it is the reason behind temperate cyclones. So occluded front is a front where instead of pushing of air masses against each other, we have a different mechanism where the air masses converge. So we can see convergence happens in regions where there is low pressure system. I've explained this in my previous videos. So convergence is associated with low pressure at the center, whereas there is upliftment of this air, and this upliftment is associated with divergence in the upper layers of atmosphere. So we'll see this with the example of jet streams later. But for now, remember that occluded front is convergence of two air masses. So we know that there is a cold air mass and then we have a warm air mass. So in a warm front, we have warm air mass which is sliding over the cold air mass. And in cold front, we have cold air mass which is pushing against the warm air mass, and this warm air mass gets completely uplifted. So this is about cold and warm front. So in occluded front, we have a combination of both cold and warm fronts with the help of convergence. So we can see here we have a cold front. In here we have warm front. So this is warm front, this is cold front. So what happens is when there is convergence, so this is one air mass, this is one air mass. So this is pushing in this direction, the other one is pushing this way. So in this case, we can see the warmest air mass is sliding over the colder air mass. So here it creates a warm front. And we know that cold air mass is quite quicker compared to the warm air mass. As a result, the cold air mass pushes at much greater speed. And with its movement, we have the upliftment of warm air mass. So this is nothing but occlusion. Occlusion is simply the total upliftment of warm air mass by cold air mass. So here in this front region, we see the formation of cumulonimbus clouds. So in this front region, we see the formation of nimbostratus clouds. As this cold air mass is pushing at a greater speed, it at some time simply outpaces the warm air mass and it completely uplifts the warm air region in this particular region. So once this cold air mass is completely moving towards the warm air mass, all this region will be uplifted. All this warm air will be uplifted. So this is occlusion. Occlusion is nothing but complete isolation of warm air mass. So in this particular case, we have complete cold air mass at the surface, that is near the surface, whereas above the cold air mass, we have the warm air mass. But the warm air mass being higher in altitude and being unstable, it simply precipitates in the form of rain. So after a certain time, the warm air mass will be completely get destroyed, and it will be the cold air mass completely occupies the ground level. So during this occlusion state, there will be intense amount of rainfall. Once the occlusion is over, the front simply dissipates. That is, the rain formation simply stops, but the ground surface will have very low temperatures because of complete occupation by the cold front. So this is occluded front is the reason behind cyclonogenesis, that is temperate cyclones. Cyclonogenesis is the formation of cyclones. So if you consider temperate cyclones, occluded front is like the backbone of temperate cyclones. So there are two kinds of occlusion. One is warm, other one is cold. We can see whether which kind of fronts are created during the occlusion process. In this, we see there is occlusion of cold and warm fronts. In the other case, the warm front dominates, where the warm front is pushing against the cold front. In the above case, we have cold front pushing against the warm front. So this kind of occlusion is called as cold front occlusion, and this kind of occlusion is called as warm front occlusion. So this is not so important topic. Now let us look at in sequence. First we have a stationary front, and then we have convergence, which is beginning. And after the convergence, so this is convergence stage, the convergence becomes intense, and the cold front, cold air mass breaks into two regions. One which is being used by the warm air mass to slide over, and the other one being this region which is pushing against the warm air mass. So we have two cold air masses and one warm air mass in the occluded front type. So here we can see the occlusion is almost complete, that is all the warm air mass will be uplifted. In the final stages, the simply complete cloud formation will be above the cold region. There will be significant amount of rainfall, and after some time, there will be complete destruction of warm air mass. So this is just a graphic. So beginning with the stationary front, we have parallel air movements, and then there is convergence, the warm front pushing against the cold. And so this is the warm region where the warm air front is sliding over the cold ones. And here it is getting occluded. The warm air mass is getting occluded. So if you look at the cloud formation, this is quite similar to the warm and cold fronts. We have seen that in the warm fronts, we see the formation of nimbus stratus clouds, whereas in cold fronts, we see the formation of cumulonimbus clouds. So as occluded front is a combination of cold and warm fronts, we see both these kind of clouds at the junction region or at the front region, and hence this region will have very intense rainfall compared to the other kind of fronts. So occluded front is completely very intense with respect to rainfall, and this is the primary reason behind temperate cyclones. So we can just look at the table at what time what happens before passing, while passing, and after passing. This is just a simple one. You need not remember everything, just for understanding purpose I've given this table. Now let us quickly move on to temperate cyclones. So temperate cyclone mechanism is exact similar to the occluded front, except that we'll see a few more concepts. So temperate cyclones occur between 35 to 65 degree north and south latitudes. They're also called as extratropical because they exist beyond tropics. They're also called as wave cyclones and frontal cyclones. See, frontal cyclones because it is formed due to the occlusion front. So cyclonogenesis is completely dependent on occluded front formation along with the path of jet streams. So jet streams play a very important role in determining the path as well as the intensity of temperate cyclones. So the same example, same explanation, we have a stationary front just like in the occluded front. We have a cold and warm air mass pushing against each other, and in the next stage we'll see the complete occlusion. And once occlusion occurs, the cyclone simply dissipates. So this is the case where the cyclone is very intense. So these three cases we see intense amount of rainfall. Once this stage is passed, the rainfall gets less intense and it finally ceases, which is called as dissipation of cyclone. So now the most important concept here is the impact of jet streams. So when we study about occluded front, we don't consider much about jet streams, but when we say about temperate cyclones are occluded fronts which are under the influence of jet streams. So how do jet streams influence temperate cyclones? So in my previous video on jet streams, I've explained how there is divergence in the upper levels of atmosphere where there is a trough region. So this region of the jet stream is called as trough, whereas this region is called as ridge. The trough region creates divergence in the upper levels of troposphere. So jet streams usually flow only in the upper levels of troposphere. When we consider polar jet stream, it is about 8 to 9 kilometers above the Earth's surface. So we see here it will be a divergence movement. So when there is divergence, this divergence is created due to the movement of jet stream. This trough region creates an anticyclonic condition in the upper levels of troposphere. Here we can see this is divergence in the upper levels of troposphere. Divergence in the upper levels is associated with upliftment of air as it creates a vacuum. So this vacuum is filled by uplifting air, and upliftment creates a low pressure system at the bottom, and low pressure system is associated with convergence. So in tropical regions, usually air converges, whereas in temperate regions, instead of just air, we see the air parcel itself is converging. Air parcel is nothing but the air mass. So in temperate regions, what we see is the convergence of air masses. So this convergence creates different kinds of fronts. Other fronts like stationary, warm and cold usually converge in almost in opposite directions, whereas the occluded front, we see both warm and cold fronts, cold air masses converge in the form of convergence or a wheeling motion, a spiraling effect will be seen. In the other case, we see there is ridge. Ridge is associated with anticyclonic flow in the upper levels, and in the lower levels, this is associated with high pressure region. We see there is subsidence of air, and as it will be an high pressure region, so this region will be a region of clear calmness and very stable conditions, whereas this region will be a region of very unstable conditions with the huge amount of rainfall. And in the other case, we have a jet streak, where jet streak flows from a broad channel into a narrow channel and then it exits into a very broad region. This is simply the changing shape of jet stream. So in this case, where there is jet stream which is entering from a broad region to a narrow region, we see convergence in the upper layers, which is associated with divergence at the bottom layers. In the other case, where the jet streak is flowing out of the narrow region, we see divergence in the upper levels associated with convergence in the bottom layers. So again, this is how the jet streams influence the path. For example, jet streams change their shape that is the meandering shape of the jet stream will be changed frequently. For example, it can change its shape in few days. So during this changing shape, usually this low pressure system is moving across, moving along this trough region. For example, this trough might have been somewhere here a few weeks back. So this low pressure system would have been somewhere here. So when the trough region has moved somewhere in this place, then the low pressure system will be here. So this is how the low pressure system moves along with the trough region of jet stream. So this is how jet streams influence the movement of temperate cyclones. Again, remember that we have tropical cyclones. When we see in detail about tropical cyclones, we'll have a better understanding of both temperate and tropical cyclones. In tropical cyclones, they flow from east to west and suddenly they shift towards north at a particular latitude. Whereas in temperate cyclones, we have west to east flow of temperate cyclones. This is because of westerlies or jet streams. We know that jet streams flow from west to east, and hence the direction of temperate cyclones will be from west to east. So this is the flow path of temperate cyclones. So just look at this figure. We have three low pressure regions here and here and here. So these three pressure regions are indicated by a symbol. We can see this is the symbol for occluded front. So here it is also occluded front, and then this is also an occluded front. So this is dissipating stage of occluded front. Almost the cyclone is at the final stages. Here we can see occluded front is a combination of cold and warm front. Here it is stationary front. Usually stationary front also sees significant amount of rainfall, but not as intense as occluded front. So this is also stationary front, and we have here occlusion, combination of warm and cold fronts. So this is how temperate cyclone behavior is. So again, the same graphic example like in the occluded front. Just a recap. Convergence. And then we have occlusion begins. The cold ones is pushing at first much faster rate. And almost occlusion is complete in this stage. Once this air mass completely pushes, the occlusion is over. So this is all about temperate cyclones. Now let us see about the distribution of temperate cyclones. Here is a map which is showing the distribution of both tropical and temperate cyclones. The green ones are tropical cyclones, whereas the black lines we are indicating the path of tropical cyclones, sorry, temperate cyclones. It is clearly observed, visible that the temperate cyclones are moving from west to east. So this is how their direction is because of the westerly movement of jet stream as well as the westerly winds in the temperate region. Whereas we have east to west flow of tropical cyclones. Again, this mechanism is aided by different mechanisms. So we'll study in detail when studying about tropical cyclones. Now let us see a question. Which one of the following areas marked as A, B, C and D in the given figure of the cyclone witness heavy torrential short duration rainfall accompanied by thunderstorms? So remember that figure of cyclone witness heavy torrential short duration rainfall accompanied by thunderstorms. So whatever may be the question, from the figure itself we can understand that this is an example for occluded front. So this the figure is not so clear, but this region is the region of warm cold front, and this region is the region of warm front, and we can see they are converging, and this is the region where occlusion of air takes place, and this is the region where there is low pressure center. So we can see the low pressure center has the maximum amount of rainfall in the occluded front system, where it has both cumulonimbus and nimbostratus clouds. So the region pointed by C will have the greatest amount of torrential rainfall. So this is all about air mass fronts and temperate cyclones. So if you like my video, please give a like, and you can comment, give your opinion. If you have any doubts or if you found anything as contradictory to the accepted explanation, then you can simply criticize or comment or give your feedback. And subscribe to my channel. I'll be posting more videos. And